Very pleased to hear that Williams will be using a full Mercedes powertrain from 22 onwards. That means the same engine, of course, but now they're going to be switching to the Mercedes gearbox. We've done a lot on that gearbox on this channel. It's a beautiful gearbox, that Mercedes cassette system. It allows for great structural integrity of the overall case, whilst inside you can basically just change ratios, do whatever you need. Not that changing ratios these days is much of an issue. But then when anyone at Williams would look over their shoulder at, say, what Force India stroke Racing Point have been doing with the Mercedes engine, in other words, mating it to the Mercedes transmission system as well, there's always been this unanswered question: if we had the Mercedes gearbox, would we have a very different rear end on the car? Would we have better traction? Would we have more geometrical advantages that perhaps we cannot get with our own gearbox? And here it has to be said, since we've got into the hybrid era, the advantages of that very small, very light Williams gearbox have kind of faded away because of all the other architecture that's needed around the back end of the car. And so it's been on a job list at Williams over the last 4 to 5 years for sure to try to see whether or not they could make the move to run the Mercedes gearbox system, replacing that beautiful Williams work of art. And I have to say, I'm kind of surprised that when Lawrence Stroll arrived at Williams with his son Lance driving there, obviously with a big budget ready to spend, that wasn't the first things that he spent his money on. The delta of going to the Mercedes gearbox from the Williams transmission works out at about £4 million. That sounds like a lot of money in some regards. In Formula One terms, it's not a massive amount. It's not a massive amount, for example, compared with the delta that Zak Brown faced when he went from Honda to Renault, which was over £30 million just to make that engine change. So we're talking about £4 million here. Of course, there would have been some redundancies from the machine shop area of the factory, but at the same time, probably those very good personnel could have been merged over to Mercedes, given the expertise of their work level. But that never happened, and personally, I'm not an engineer, but personally, I think one of the reasons Williams have been suffering so much over the last 3 to 4 years, 5 years, is because they don't have that Mercedes transmission system in the car. Now, very sadly, they can't make the change for this year, for the 2021 season. It's far too late, and they're committed basically to running the same car as last year, as are virtually all the other Formula One teams. But for 2022, the regulations are going to change, and from then on in, Williams will be running with the Mercedes transmission. That is a really good move. And apart from anything else, I think this shows that the new owners of Williams have got a really sharp idea of how to move into the future. The arrival of Jos Capito as the new chief executive officer and Simon Roberts staying on as the team principal, I think gives a certain credibility to Williams now, which has been lacking over the 4 to 5 years. And I think when they're going up against the Mercedes board and looking for ways to develop a relationship with Mercedes, a little bit along the lines of, dare I say it, Racing Point, then I think the Jos Capito factor will be very, very important. And then beyond that, what a brilliant thing to have George Russell now still with the team. He was always good. We always said that Williams were going to get better with George there, not only because of how quick he is and how good he is, but because he's so polished at working with people and getting the best from them. You can just tell in the way he is on the radio. Everything is energized with George, and that's exactly what they need. And having had that taste of driving for Mercedes and Williams knowing how quick George is in a winning car like the Mercedes can only be beneficial. They know the standard at which George can operate. Equally, George has a feel now for what it's like to be in a team like Mercedes, and he will be able to impart that into the Williams team in 21, 22 if he's staying there as well, almost by osmosis. Nicholas Latifi is a very, very good number two. He brings good sponsorship to the team, and he's not slow either. And I still think one of the dark horses at Williams is Doug McKiernan, the aerodynamicist. We haven't really yet seen the full product of his work. And that's because there are so many other issues in the development of the car. It's a building block thing. It does take time. And aerodynamically, there's only so much you can do if you have other limitations on the car. And the new owners look as if they know what they're doing. They're spending their money correctly. They've got good people in there. They've still got a great facility. And of course, they've still got a great name. So Frank Williams is not great over the Christmas period, but the good news is that he's back at home now, making recovery. All the best to you, Frank. And all the best to everybody at Williams. It's a great name to have in Formula One. And it looks like now as if they are on the road to genuine recovery.